I want to speak on the subject divine exemption. Divine exemption. And I'll be reading my text from the book of Malachi chapter 3 from verse 16 to 18. Then those who fear the Lord spoke to one another, and the Lord listened and heard them. So a book of remembrance was written before him for those who fear the Lord and who meditate on his name. They shall be mine, says the Lord of hosts, on the day that I make them my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spares his own son who serves him. Then you shall again discern between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who does not serve him. Divine exemption. The Bible here captures for us the activities that transpired between a specific group of people. And the Bible classifies this group of people as those who fear the Lord. So that means there are those who fear God, and there are those who don't fear God. And the prophet Malachi, by the privilege of revelation, stood at the council of the Lord to see God's response to those who fear the Lord. The Bible says they spoke to one another. They spoke to one another. If you read the preceding verses, there was a complaint that God was not rewarding service, and that the wicked were prospering. Those who were proud were prospering, and it was becoming unfashionable to be committed to God, because some persons felt there was nothing to show for their service. And so God spoke to them. And when he spoke to them and told them that the days will come, it will become clear, there will be a distinction between those who serve God and those who don't serve God. Now that distinction will be made manifest by a divine exemption. God says, I will spare them as a man who spares his son who serves him. So a day is coming, and of course the ultimate day is the day of judgment, when we all will stand before the Lord to give a stewardship of this gift called the breath of life, the mortal life that have been committed to mankind. Every believer has two kinds of life. You have the mortal life, and you also have the eternal life. But unbelievers only have mortal life. It's called the breath of life in the nostrils of all flesh. The mortal life is the life that keeps this human being and all flesh animals in existence, that keeps you going, that enables this complex machine called man to keep functioning, is called the breath of life. For man was dust, until God breathed the life and his spirit into man, and that dust became a living soul. But there is another kind of life that is encapsulated in the spirit of God within our spirit. That is the very life of God, eternal life, which is being administered through our spirit by the Holy Ghost as we conform to the image of God. He said unto us, I've been given these precious promises. But those precious promises will become a reality as we conform to the image of God, because we already have his divine nature. And that will usher us to the dimension of the supernatural. Whoever is not born again is natural, is earthly. But he who is born again is supernatural, is heavenly. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. So a day will come when we will all stand before God to give stewardship of the gift called life that has been entrusted to us. And God says, in that day, those who fear God and serve him will be made jewels. Glory to God. That is the day God will showcase those who fear him. He will make them jewels. They will be reckoned as special, as unique, as unusual. God will decorate them that day. And that is the ultimate day when God will prove that it pays to fear and serve him. It pays to fear and serve him. For those who fear him and serve him will be ushered into eternal life to spend their eternity with God. Eternal life has not been delivered to us in its fullness. We've received the life, but we have not received the body that life is truly being created for or has been made for. When you prepare an engine, you also prepare a vehicular body for that engine. So every race car has a particular body prepared for it, and the ground clearance is usually low because it's meant to run. So the weight is on the ground, so that it does not matter how fast it runs, it does not somersault. So, but when you make that kind of engine for a race car, you put it on a bicycle, there will be limitations. So this eternal life that God has given to us needs an eternal body. But that eternal body is still in heaven. And the reason why God cannot give us that eternal body now is because if he gives us that eternal body, the law of gravity and the laws that operate in the earth will no longer be able to hold us. Once you receive that body, you will ascend to heaven. So that body has been kept for us in heaven until the day of rapture, when the trumpet will sound and Jesus will come with the cry of an archangel, and the dead in Christ will be raised first, and we that are alive will all be transformed. That is when the body will be given to us. And when this body is given to us, we'll beat the law of gravity. Then it will be said that death has been swallowed up in victory. then it will become clear that there is a clear distinction between those who serve God, who fear God and serve Him, and those who don't. In that day will be made a jewel, a spectacle. Do you understand that? Why we who are alive in Christ Jesus, whether those raised and those who have been living, will be made jewels. The others who don't make heaven will be made woods. Because while we enter into eternal life, those who don't serve God and fear Him will enter into eternal damnation, everlasting condemnation. But that's not my focus at the moment. My focus at the moment is to encourage you to understand that in this year 2021, you need to reassess your service and commitment to the fear of the Lord. You need to reassess it. And the reason why you need to reassess it is because of the evil that will befall the earth this year. And you need a divine exemption. If you read the book of Revelation, the Bible says, before the four angels that heard the four winds of the earth will let it go, an angel cried out and said, do not let the wind go until those who have been chosen by God are sealed on their forehead, the servants of God. It was talking about the elect that will be saved among the children of Israel. And the Bible says he began to see 144,000 persons from each tribe. So in other words, before things happen in the earth, there are those who are usually by divine exemption delivered from the carnage, from the affliction, from the challenges, the sickness, the death, and the attack of the enemy. Job, for instance, was one of those who by divine exemption could not be touched by Satan. When Satan came in the midst of the sons of God who came to give an account of their stewardship upon the face of the earth, to account for the responsibility that they have been discharged with to accomplish upon the face of the earth. When they came and Satan came up, so the Bible says, God said to him, where are you coming from? Where comest thou from? And he says, from going to and fro, up and down, upon the face of the earth. Now what he was saying is that, Lord, man, the earth is under the sway of my influence. I'm dominating here. Just like you are dominating over there, I'm in charge here. And God said, no, I still have weaknesses on the earth. Have you considered my servant Job? And God began to give the curriculum vitae of this man. A man who fears God, eschews evil, a man who loves righteousness. Now Satan revealed something there. He said, does Job fear God for nothing? In verse 10, Job 1 verse 10. He said, has thou not set an edge round about him? What is that? Divine exemption. Every other person can be attacked, but not Job. Every other person can be afflicted, not Job. Not his family, not his household, not all that pertains to him. That's why the moment God gave Satan the approval to touch him, when divine exemption was lifted off the life of Job, the divine injunction not to touch Job was lifted. Satan in one day made sure all that Job had perished. He says, does Job fear God for nothing? Has that not set an edge round about him? So there's an hedge. An invisible hedge of divine exemption that kept evil away, that kept affliction attack away. That's why all homes don't experience the same thing. All individuals don't experience the same thing. Death can come to a place, like in the NSAS protest, that bullets were shot into the crowd. Do you understand that? There are those that the bullet would have hit, but narrowly they moved like this, and the person beside them was hit and fell down and died. Things don't just happen, my dear. There is an invisible world that controls this visible world. The physical things that we see are made from things that are not visible. They're made from the word of God. So when you see realities on the earth, they are the result of what has transpired in the realm of the spirit. So Job was untouchable. In the days of Daniel, where was Daniel when Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego were being ushered by the decree of the king to the furnace of fire? Where was Daniel? Did he travel? He didn't travel, he was there. But you see, by this Daniel's service walk with God, divine exemption had been given as an injunction concerning him. The image that was set up to be worshipped was the image of the king. But by God's dealing with this man, he had brought dimensions of revelations that even the king had to bow down and worship him. You know, Nebuchadnezzar worshipped Daniel. When he told him his dreams and gave him interpretation, the Bible says he commanded that an incense be offered to Daniel. They put a golden chain on his hand. The king of all the earth bowed to a man. Straight. Oh God. See, when you commit to serving God in the fear of the Lord, you become unique. You become special. You become distinct from all men. All men are not the same. All women are not the same. We are all unique in our own way. But there are men who have committed themselves to worship, to serve, to seek God, that they stand in a class alone, apart from other men, a class of their own. When you hear God talk about his friend, who comes to mind? Abraham. Who else is a friend of God? That God himself announced and said, this is my friend. When God talked about somebody who fears God, eschews evil, you remember Job. When God talks about a man after his own heart, you remember David. Do you understand that? When God talks about a perfect man, you remember Noah. He says he was perfect in his generation. There are men that have singled themselves from generation to generation. When God talks about a man that walked with him, you remember Enoch. You can look through scripture. Men who have distinguished themselves. A man greatly beloved. You hear of Daniel. Amen. Every man has his own level, uniqueness of walk with God that have created a platform, a class for him. Have thou considered my servant Job? One who fears God. And you see, all these unique men, patriarchs of faith, enjoyed the law of divine exemption. Abraham left where he was supposed to be, entered Egypt, and the king took his wife, even though he told a lie, although it was partly true and partly lie. Sarah was his sister or half sister. But the Bible says God struck the king, closed the womb of animals, wives. The hand of God was against the king. The king had to let go. In the case of Abimelech, the king of the Philistines in Gerar, God visited him in a dream and said, you are a dead man. Not you will die, you're already dead. You took the wife of my servant, my prophet, my friend forever. Ah, you are finished. And the Bible said by morning light, he quickly restored Sarah to Abraham and then called his people and gave them a child. He said, the one who touches this man or his wife is dead. No, we die. He's already dead. You see how God defends these people who served him. Look at the life of David and compare it with that of Saul. What was Saul's crime? He disobeyed the commandment of God. Now, is that as grievous as a man? Because Saul disobeyed the command and didn't kill. I know disobedience or rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. God doesn't want rebellion. But a man preserved the life of somebody God has appointed to die. And that man also didn't seek the face of God, and the Bible says for his unfaithfulness which he committed against the word of God, God killed him. Now David took a man's wife. Remember the story of Bathsheba. Committed adultery with her, she became pregnant, tried to cover it, and when he couldn't cover, he sent for her husband Uriah, and Uriah came. He was too righteous, too disciplined to go to his own house. That's a man who fears God, who serves God. He said, how can the ark of the Lord be in the open field, and my Lord Joab and the men, and then I will come to my house, come to the land, get to my house, and not me, lie with my wife, not me. A man of sacrifice. And David killed that man with the sword of the enemy. And do you know that God didn't kill David? Even though he judged him, he paid with 4 sons, and God sent him away from the kingdom, from the palace. He vacated the throne for some time. God punished him, but didn't kill him. David counted Israel, and when God would judge, God began to kill the men of Israel. And David said, Lord, I am the one who is guilty. I'm the one who sinned. Lord, let your hand be against me. And God didn't kill him. I have found a man after my own heart who will do all my will. And David served his generation according to the will of God. So therefore, in that day, when I make them my joy, I will spare them as a man spares his son who serves him. So the one who served his generation according to the will of God was spared. And the man who didn't serve his generation according to the will of God was destroyed. In fact, God wiped him, his children, and wiped every his men, everything. We are talking about divine exemption. That this year you will have a hedge around you. It does not matter the COVID-19, the afflictions, the arrows that are flying by day and night. You will be preserved. Nothing will strike you. The sun won't strike you by day, nor the moon by night. But the prerequisite is that you will serve the Lord in the fear of the Lord. You will serve him according to his will. You know, serving God, some of us think that you can just do anything you like. No, if you don't walk with God, you can't serve him. It takes walking with God, building your relationship with God, knowing God, so that you can serve him accurately. There are many things I'd love to do, many places I would have liked to go. When I traveled to Uganda, I was asked to come to South Sudan. I didn't want to go. But the Lord said, go. I had no money for visa and for my fare. The Lord made provision available. They had said they would not give me visa, but they changed their mind and gave me visa. And when I went, God glorified his name. The healings, the lives that were touched, the encouragement, the strengthening. At the end of the day, I thanked God that I went. So there are places and things I would not want to do, but because God is saying, this is what I want you to do, then I have to do it. I have to do it. We don't serve according to our will. We serve according to his will. It is he who has made us. We are the sheep of his pasture. He has created us for his pleasure. So this year, seek the Lord and find out his will for your life, his assignment for your life, what he will have you do, and be committed to it sacrificially. Serve him with all your heart, with all your mind. Invest your time, your energy, your resource for God's kingdom. And then the law of divine exemption will be issued concerning you, so he would spare you as a man spares his son who serves him. And I pray for you that you would come to a higher level of sacrifice in serving God. And you will commit your time, your energy, you consistently put in all you've got to his service. And that this year would be a year of promotion of the power and of the glory for you in the mighty name of Jesus. May you not be wasted. What is wasting or will waste others will not waste you. And it does not matter what is going on out there, you'll be exempted. The Lord will spare you as a man spares his son who serves him. In Jesus' name. I want you to pray this morning that the Lord will help you. That the Lord will help you to make commitment this year to serve him in the fear of the Lord. A lot of people don't fear God. The fear of the Lord is to depart from iniquity. People don't fear God anymore. Yes, we should serve God because we love him. But brethren, I tell you whom you will fear. Don't fear him who can destroy the flesh and that will be it. But fear him who, having destroyed the flesh, can destroy the soul and the spirit. I say to you, fear him. Don't just love him, fear him. Lord, help me to serve you in the fear of the Lord. In the fear of the Lord. Help me to serve you in the fear of the Lord. Makali keto na pranda, yikali mozo prefetene kali baro zutanda, ikali makonderi prefetono zukali gande breno. Lord, help me to fear you, Lord, and serve you in the fear of the Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed.